The first question is, who of you were here last year for this presentation?
You were, okay, you'll know my bad jokes already.
So, what we have going on right now is, we will always have kind of a changing landscape, which is closely tied to the federal budgeting process. In case you haven't heard, there are some changes in Congress and in the President's office, and the budgeting process is even more uncertain than it has been in past years. So I'll get to this point in the talk, but the idea here is that we don't really know when the awards will be announced and exactly how many, but the prospects are not particularly bright. The announcement was that they're going to be cut in half for this year. So I'll give you the bad news now and hopefully try to lift your spirits as we go through the rest of the presentation. Okay, so what I'm going to do today is talk about the National Science Foundation in general. I think it's good to know the landscape of who it is you're asking money from and what they're supposed to be doing so you can speak their language. The purpose of the GRF, which is NSF's oldest program. It was there in the very first year. It was actually 43% of their total budget in the very first year. Over the years, things have shifted to research assistants rather than fellows, but it's still very central to NSF's mission and mandate and operations. I'll briefly describe benefits and eligibility. There are a few tweaks here this year. The review criteria, I'll spend a fair amount of time here because that's what you are going to be reviewed on, so you might as well write to those specific criteria. I'll talk about the format. I want to emphasize right now, and I'll repeat it again, this is an application, not a proposal. The whole structure looks much more like your application for admission to graduate school than it does a traditional NSF or NIH research proposal. The research you're proposing to do is part of your overall package, an important part, but it is not the only part. It's an application, not a proposal. The review process. This is, if you will, where all that sausage gets made. How do they tear apart your application relative to all the others in the pile and come up with a set of recommendations? The panelists recommend, the program officers decide. So remember that fact. For the most part, they take the panelists' recommendations, but it's not 100%. And finally, how you are notified of the outcomes of their deliberations. Okay, so the National Science Foundation is an outgrowth of our World War II scientific enterprise, and a lot of the structures and overall organization of our scientific support from a federal level is based on ideas and procedures that were developed in World War II. We were in growth phase there. We realized that we needed to fuel that growth with financial support. And central to that support was the notion that we needed to fund researchers in their early stages as well as throughout their career. Now, NSF was founded in 1950. You see that the specific organic language was to promote the progress of science, advance national health, prosperity, and welfare, to secure national defense. Taking that from the back, you can still do research that appeals to military applications and be fully funded by NSF. It's particularly important in areas that focus on defense in a broad sense as opposed to military operations. So there can be defense-related, whether it's biodefense or whether it's IT security or what have you, but that's important in what they want to fund. Partly because NSF has to justify this funding. If you have an idea that's in an area that can contribute to our overall welfare, that's the United States and citizenship, good, that gives you some extra points. It's not to say you can't do more esoteric research, it's just that that becomes visible, particularly in certain disciplines like engineering. Welfare, prosperity, health, all great things, but there was a split early on, a couple of splits, but one split was that most health research in the U.S. is supported by NIH, not NSF. And that's where there's some trickiness. If you were doing biomedical research that's heavy on the clinical application, you may well be better supported by NIH and may be ineligible for NSF support. So follow that language clearly. And that is not just bedside pharmaceutical administration, but it could be certain areas of psychology. It could be certain areas of some other areas where you would think medicine, and you don't quite know. if you focus on the basic science involved, you're generally safe. I'll jump to the conclusion here, and then my suggestion is avoid the use of the word clinical in your application, if this is where you are. Now, there are some areas, like if you're working on prosthetics, whether it be robotics, or whether it be feedback, or whether it be mechanics, whatever it is, that's an area of medicine which NSF can support. But read the language in the solicitation and confer with the operations center if you have any questions on that one. And then finally, the progress of science. Everything you should be doing is moving knowledge forward, moving scientific knowledge forward. Show what you are going to do as part of your training and research, how that will move understanding forward. New ideas, new perspectives, all that. You want to show novelty in there, not just, I'm going to repeat something that someone else already did. Now, this next point about all fields, but the clinical biomedical areas, which are normally covered by NIH, again, read the solicitation, which is the most important document you can read for this. Clarify the issue with the operations center if you have a problem. And if you are still a little uncertain, say you are working in a lab and your lab has had NSF funding, point that out in your application. Because if NSF has already funded it, it's already passed a hurdle there, and you should be able to justify your application. Now, roughly speaking, NSF gets well over 10,000, or issues over 10,000 awards each year. Of that, 1,000 new GRFs are going to come out this year. Last year, it was about 2,000. The previous few years, it was about 2,000. The previous administration had a keen interest in the GRF and overall doubled its size during its term. Now we are in a different frame of view, and it's likely this results in a lot of a significant reduction in the number of awards. I don't know if 1,000 will be the actual number. We won't really know until March or April, but that's the proposed number right now. Now, most of you probably pick up some support as a graduate research assistant, and that's where things have shifted over the years. In the beginning, it was mostly fellowships. Now it's mostly research assistantships. The idea here is that it's a principal investigator, your advisor, who's calling the shots. He or she is getting a research award and identifying students that he or she wants to support in the form of a research assistantship. The fellowship is unique, and that is your award. That's something that you can do what you want with up to a point. So the purpose of a graduate research fellowship is to identify those individuals early in their careers who show potential and promise to be high-achieving scientists and engineers. Roughly speaking, the numbers are about a third of the applications are from engineers, about a third for biologists, and about a third from everywhere else. The social sciences are represented, but collectively it's only about 15-20% across all the social sciences that NSF supports. I say that because I know a lot of social sciences in the office here. Now, early in your careers, this has become a greater emphasis more recently, and is also part of the process of trimming back the number of, if you will, spurious applications, one that just wouldn't go very far anyway, and actually in the end, reducing the number of chances that you have. So this is where eligibility comes in, and I'll get to that in the next slide. Now, the two review criteria, which I'll expand on in a second or two, look at the scientific merit, the intellectual merit that you have, how well you did as an undergraduate, what kind of research activities you've been engaged in, et cetera, but also how you can help broaden participation in the sciences. And this can be directly. Obviously, if you're coming from a background that's not well represented in the sciences, you, if you're funded, are helping them broaden participation. But this is also through your activities. If you are working with underserved groups or underrepresented groups, K through 12 tutoring, or summer camp, or writing letters in critical newspapers, letters to the editor, anything like that, it helps broaden participation. I can't begin to tell you how important it is to show that you are broadening participation in your application, in one way or another. Mind you, just being from an underrepresented group doesn't mean you're necessarily going to be given advantages. You have to show that you're actually broadening participation. Okay, now, NSF has an overall strategy, but a key word here is workforce. This is a big surprise to me. When I went to NSF, I thought, oh, you're just funding people to be academics, and there's an academic workforce. I never looked at faculty as being part of the workforce. Work, just that I didn't view it as this process where they had gone through some kind of training to get them that job. But indeed, they do, that's how NSF looks at it. You go back to that original language after World War II, they wanted to ensure a vibrant workforce in the scientific disciplines, engineering disciplines. And the language that actually created the GRF specifically stated men and women. It wasn't just to say it was the brightest man. So this broad participation component has been there from the very beginning. Okay, now, the specifics are still 3 years of support spread out over a 5-year period. You get to pick the 3 years. But this involves some discussion with your home institution, specifically the individual which was referred to as a coordinating official, and Maria happens to be the coordinating official for Georgetown. So you would only have a conversation with her. But another key point here is that this is research-based, so coursework only programs don't qualify. It is master's and doctoral. This is the graduate research fellowship, not the doctoral research fellowship. Truth be told, master's degree programs typically aren't strong enough to garner too many awards. You're only there for a couple of years at the most. So why are you asking for 3 years of funding? If, however, you can play out a discussion as to how you're going to go for the master's and continue on to a doctoral degree based on your master's experience, it could be viable. And in some states like Texas, you're technically admitted to a master's program first, then the full doctoral degree. Okay. Now, the more detail on the benefits here is that 3 years of support over a 5-year period, a pretty nice annual stipend. This is what you get, you walk away with. It's paid by your home institution, though. The institution gets tuition support. You don't see that directly. They're obliged to cover the rest of your tuition for those years. And if you were to kind of look at the total package here, it's one of the more robust. However, know that there are other fellowship programs out there, several from the federal government, like the NDSEG and a few others. Be careful, because the specifics of the award need to be carefully weighed. How much are they giving you? How much are they giving your institution? When can you take it? In some cases, it's a block 3 years or 2 years. In some cases, you can spread it out. Also, be careful, because in general, you're usually only allowed to take one of those fellowships. This is not by NSF's rules, but by the other program's rules. The NDSEG, for instance. You take theirs, or you take the other one, but not both. It used to be that if you went both, you could spread out a lot of support and be on fellowship for your entire stay in graduate school, but not anymore. Whether you get an award or not, if you fall into the next category, which is honorable mention, where you get the award, you also qualify for some high-performance computing resources if you apply for that. And then for awardees, there are a range of international experiences that they've developed. Typically, you're going to an international lab and spending 3 months or 6 months or whatever on their nickel, and it's something that you just work out with NSF in an additional review process for those awards. Key thing there is that if you have an international component to your research, by all means, spell it out. Whether or not there's a lab in that country that you're interested in working in, there might be an international lab that's doing research that could accommodate your plan and helps build out a more robust international portfolio for you. Okay, eligibility criteria. Here's where there's a big change over the last 2 years. You can be a senior in college. You can be a post-baccalaureate student, meaning you have graduated with a bachelor's degree, but you have not yet taken a graduate course. Or you can be a first or second year graduate student. The second year graduate student is defined as having no more than whatever the equivalent of 12 months of study is as of August 1st of that year. Now, for those of you who are in your second year of graduate school now, the traditional student, you started a year ago. You had no more than 12 months of study as of August 1st of this year, so you're eligible to apply. If, for example, you took courses before a year ago, you would then have more than 12 months of study and therefore not eligible to apply.
but 90% of the students out there start in August or September for their academic year, and as of August 1st, at the end of that first full year of graduate study, you have no more than 12 months of study, so you're eligible in that second year of graduate study. It's a little tricky, but for most students, it's pretty straightforward. Now, you're allowed to reapply if you finished your graduate study and have a break of a couple of years. That's something which you need to be very careful with and show that you've done something with that extra time. Whether it be working, or you were in the hospital for 2 years, or whatever it is, you need to show that something was going on there. And it could be a complete change of focus, but you need to describe what that is. Cutting to the chase in this one, you need to tell your story, the narrative of who you are, how you got to where you are, what motivates you, et cetera, et cetera. And what you did in that break is part of that story. Okay, now, the big change over the past year is that as a graduate student, once you take that first class, you're allowed only one submission, whether it be your first year or your second year. It used to be last year, as a matter of fact, was the last year it happened. You could do both years, but this year, only one. What that means is that if you have a really good idea and you're a first year graduate student and you're strong, I suggest going for it. Because there will be a lot of students hesitating and waiting until the second year. And you're going to be in a better position because you're being evaluated against the other first year graduate students. If, however, you're uncertain, you feel you're going to get a lot of data this year, you feel that you have an award around the corner, some publications, or something like that, which would put you in a stronger position next year, then it might be prudent to wait. Now, for those of you who are undergraduates, I'd say go for it. If you have even a remote idea as to what you want to do, there's a very large number of undergraduates now shifting into the applicant load because of this change. If you went for it, you have nothing to lose. You still have 1 year of eligibility as a graduate student. Now, if you're in that middle ground, finishing your bachelor's degree, and you're serving as a research assistant, or field staff, or a job and working, you're still eligible as an undergraduate. You're in this undergraduate post-baccalaureate state because you have not taken a graduate course yet. So you can weigh off the odds there. In certain disciplines, it's not uncommon for a student to graduate, spend a few years working in the trenches, then go into graduate school. And in many cases, they're associated with the university, they're doing lab work, they're getting publications and grants, they're sitting in seminars, they just don't have status as a graduate student. And in many cases, they're getting a better education than graduate students are, because they're in the trenches doing the work rather than slogging through some intro coursework, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, now, citizenship, citizen, national, permanent resident. There may be, in this climate, closer scrutiny. I don't know where NSF stands on DACA for this one. I just don't know. I can't, but you'll have to confer with the Operations Center on that one if you fit into that category. But most students are pretty straightforward on this, and you don't need to prove it up front, but you do need to show it after a word has been offered to you. Then finally, this discipline, research-based master's and PhD in NSF-supported fields. On the back of the solicitation is a big, long list of the NSF fields of study that are eligible. Find one or more that fit to describe your work. If you're going for the interdisciplinary approach, you'll need to identify your disciplines and the relative proportions of those. There is no interdisciplinary panel that's reviewing it, but rather your application will go to the panel for that discipline that you identified as the most important, and then they'll farm it out for additional review if it's felt that whatever other discipline represented needs to weigh in on that application. Okay. Okay. Review criteria. There are two fundamental criteria on which all NSF applications and proposals are examined. The first is the intellectual merit, and the second is the broader impacts. Intellectual merit is a straightforward one. How well did you do in school? What kind of awards did you receive? What kind of publication record do you have? What kind of scientific insights have you had? What kind of contributions have you made scientifically or intellectually? The broader impacts is all that other stuff that pertains to helping society, having a societal contribution. Now,
both are important, and they've actually recommended that you single out a section that summarizes your contributions in each area. As a student, you're going to be evaluated in ways that a principal investigator would not be evaluated. Principal investigators will have open letters of support appended to their proposals that they see, and sometimes they feed the letter writer the information. You, in contrast, will have, for the most part, confidential letters of recommendation. You won't see the letter if you waive your rights to it, but the reviewers will. So all of these pieces need to come together to show both intellectual merit and broader impacts. Okay, you can just imagine these are just expected and normal, but creative, original, potentially transformative. The potentially transformative concept was introduced by a previous NSF director, Art Bennett, who was there 10 years ago. And originally it was transformative, and then they realized, you don't know if it's transformative yet, so they made it potentially transformative. But if you have an idea there that could change the way people think in a discipline, or approach a certain problem, or conduct a research procedure or technique, then you have a chance to gain some points in that area. So emphasize what's new, creative, original, and contributing to the progress of knowledge in science. Particularly if you can show that it has the potential of transforming or changing the way people do things in an area. Well reasoned, well organized, based on a sound rationale, that's just normal. It needs to be plausible, coherent, make sense. The reviewers only have a bit of time to review these things. You need to write concisely and clearly. It needs to come across very efficiently. Plan incorporates a mechanism to assess success. Show that at the end of your plan of study and research, there are certain outcomes that you anticipate. Obviously, they won't be checking to see if you actually do that, because it's several years down the road. You might change your institution, your thesis, or what have you. But if you show that you have a timeline, that you have some idea as to how long things are going to take, what potential problems are, how you would address those, what an outcome might be 5 years down the road, the reviewer will have a sense that you know what you're talking about. Let's see, qualified to conduct the proposed activities. The single most important variable that I have seen in applications that are winners is solid undergraduate research experience. And I'm not talking about just doing an organic chemistry lab as a part of the course, but rather being engaged in some type of a project. To the degree it's original, it's yours that you pulled it together, that you did the literature research and proposed and got some funding and conducted the research, collected data, managed data, analyzed data, presented results, interpreted them, discussed your findings, got it presented as a poster or a talk or a paper. All of those things show productivity. So if you've been doing that already, the reviewers will have a sense that you know what you're talking about and that you can do this. Adequate resources for the proposed activities. Pick a school, pick a lab, pick an advisor that's appropriate for what you want to do. As a senior in college, you may not know where you're going to school yet next fall. But if you are in your second year of graduate school, you should pretty solidly be in the better part of your project. As your advisor with your institution, you know what your lab facilities are, you can describe them, you've done some background literature search, et cetera, et cetera. All that is important. So it is somewhat age relevant where you are in your development. Okay, the first of those criteria, intellectual merit. This is the text from various NSF publications. I believe this is still in the solicitation. I apologize, I recycled this slide from last year. But on the right are the things that apply to the GRF review. Things like your academic performance. To be honest, if you're a PhD faculty researcher and you're proposing a project, they're not going to ask you what your GPA was, but here they will. They'll see you with your transcripts. They want to know what kind of grade you got. Honors, awards, communication skills, how well do you write, have you given talks before, have you taught, research experience, international experience, independence, creativity, publications, show productivity. Publications are still the coin of the realm here. That's how you show productivity in science. Research plan, choice of institution, pick the one that is appropriate for you, not just the big name school. And finally, your references. This is both
what you're referencing as background literature, but also who's writing it for you, because they will be saying things about you that give a different perspective on who you are. Now, one comment about the GRE, even though the graduate research exam, or graduate record exam, was originated in no small part because of NSF and this program, because of a variety of reasons about test bias, et cetera, it is no longer even accepted by the program. It used to be they would pay you to take the exam. Now they don't even accept it. So don't even bother to put it in because they'll redact it. Broader impacts, this is the other one. This is societal benefit. This is what you have if you are doing your research as well as living a full life. How you are interacting with the public or how your project and research will interact with the public. Achievement, society, relevant outcomes. That's an important mandate for the program. And this is, as I mentioned before, where NSF has to come up with some language that they can use to justify giving you an award, or you an award, or you an award. What you're proposing to do is something that a taxpayer could relate to. Now, not always is that the case, but if you can translate what you're doing into language that the public can consume, and especially elected officials can consume and understand, then you're better off. So think about that elevator pitch, that short paragraph description that's meant for public consumption, because it goes a long way in helping the program officers justify their decisions. Now, you can get there by the research itself. It might have a societally beneficial outcome. Or it might be that it helps you come up with teaching modules. Or it helps you talk to people about ways they can solve their problems in a different discipline. Interdisciplinarity is one way of improving society. It could be that you are just including other individuals in your work. If you've been working with undergraduates, or you see high school students, or you see anyone from a disadvantaged group, and you can incorporate them into your research, great. If you've done it already, even better. But if you can do that, you can find a way to do that, build it into your discussion. Now, anything that helps STEM education is good. Did you know that the first incarnation of the acronym STEM was actually scrambled as SMET? STEM comes across a little smoother. Anyway, that's an aside. Partnerships with academia, industry, and others. It is not dirty to say that your work is marketable. There's a marketable product. My two poster children for the GRF. One measure that NSF uses to assess outcomes is whether or not you earned a PhD. So that's a measure of assessment outcome. Theodore Kaczynski, more recently in the news because of a series about him. The Unabomber, got a GRF, finishes his degree. Okay. The other one is Sergey Brin, got a GRF, came up with Google along with, what's his name, the other guy. And he never finished his PhD. So the idea here is that if there's an outcome, it's a marketable product that can be societally transformative. I think we could argue that both of those individuals transform society, one for the good, one for the not so good. But that kind of thing is not dirty language. This is not just basic, unapplied science. It can be applied science across any discipline. Working with industry, therefore, is not a problem. If there's an industry lab that you've been working with, what I'm supposed to work with, that's all been fine. But spell it out in clear terms. Improve national security, anything you do on this front is good. Be it tracking the bad guys, or be it coming with new facial recognition systems, or be it whatever it might be, computer security, biohazard disposal, whatever it is. Anything that improves national security is beneficial. Now, this increased economic competitiveness and enhanced infrastructure, if you can see that stretch, then try to include it. You come up with a new methodology or a new instrument or anything like that, that all helps. Those are outcomes that you can incorporate in your proposed activities. Again, here's the language on the left and some specifics on the right. The panels are all virtual now, but it used to be that they'd be in a room maybe this size, and they would actually put poster paper up on the walls with the keywords that they were looking for, because each discipline is a little different on what constitutes a good broader impact. In some disciplines, teaching is the norm, and others, it's rare.
In some disciplines, you know, working with a disadvantage is part of the process, in others, it's a stretch. So these kinds of things have to be kind of developed for that particular panel, for the language and calibration that went across all panelists. But now it's pretty much widespread. I'll get to it in a second, but all the panels are virtual now. This is the kind of stuff that they want to see. Now I'll tell you, K through 12 outreach and interaction is extremely common. But two things. One, if you've never done it before, be very prudent in how you describe it. Because you're saying you're going to do something which is just so commonplace that they want to know that you know what you're talking about. If you've done it before, or if you're proposing to do it, you should try to make it as creative and original as you can. There are lots of institutions that have developed these shops where you can go in and say, hey, I want to do some K through 12 outreach because I need to for this application or proposal. Can you plug me into a pre-existing program? And I say, oh yeah, we're working with this middle school downtown. Why don't you just go down and spend some time? You can put it on your resume that you have K through 12 outreach experience, but it's really not a heavy lift on your part. If you come up with new teaching model, if you go out there and forge a new relationship with a high school, if you do anything that's unique, that you initiated, spell it out. That's the kind of initiative they want to see. Be a leader, not a follower. Okay, what else we have up there? Future plans, leadership, research and education, potential to communicate to diverse audiences. Be open and be communicative. Write a letter to the editor of your local hometown newspaper about some issue that you're concerned about. You'd be surprised at how receptive they are. You have credibility as even a senior in college that many locals would appreciate. There's an issue that you're passionate about. Get out there and do it. It's a publication effort. Okay, so the materials themselves. Take a look at the ORCID database, because that's the database that they will use for a wide variety of purposes, trying to find out who panelists might be, some current language, trends. There's a wide range of reasons for doing that. But take a look at that just to get a sense as to, you know, what resource NSF might be using to pull together the panels. But you will write a personal statement, relevant background, future goal statement. These used to be separate. That's why there's a big run-on phrase right there. That's where you tell your story. That's your history. That's your personal discussion of motivation, inspiration, why you're getting into this in the first place, what's pushing you to go forward, and how their support will help you reach your goals. There's a graduate research statement. This is where you talk about the research component of your program of study. This is more of a just general biography, whereas this is the proposal part, the traditional research proposal part. You'll have three letters of reference. You put the names in Fastlane. Emails are sent out to the references. You can track their progress, whether they're in or not. You can bother them a little bit. And NSF will go with just two, but they really like to see that third one. And they'll basically ignore everything we have beyond three. So some people hedge your bet down five or six. And, you know, the first three that come in are the three that NSF sees. So be careful about using that strategy. Transcripts are uploaded into Fastlane. They just spot check and reference these to make certain that you did get the degree, if you claim to have a degree, you did take certain courses, and the reviewers will scrutinize these. Finally, as I mentioned before, the GRE scores are not accepted. Now, in this first statement, tell your story. A narrative works best, chronological or otherwise, but you want to emphasize the key things that have motivated and inspired you. You know, why is it that you want to do this? How have you prepared for this? How will this, meaning the plan of graduate study, with their support, help you develop as a scientist? In contrast to a research proposal, which is about finding some outcome based on a research plan, this is an application to help you develop into a scientific researcher. And if you show that you're preparing for it with all the tools and resources that you have, but that their help, NSF help, will allow you to go even further, that's the kind of story they want to see. If you talk about how you're so well-funded already, occasionally they'll say, well, why do you need this money? But you need to show how it's important, your plan of study. Anything you can put down about leadership skills, unique characteristics,
anything that makes you stand out. The reality is that probably 2 to 3 times as many applications as will be funded are worthy of funding. Their success rates have historically been teens. I can't even begin to imagine what they're going to be like this year. There'll probably be fewer applications overall, but with the funding dropping by half, they'll probably be low teens for the success rate this year. My wild guess. Now, have a broader plan, not just your plan of graduate study. What do you plan to do in the long term? Everybody's going to say you want to be a tenured faculty member. The reality is that in this room, maybe a quarter of you will be tenured faculty at the end of the day. It's just the way numbers work out. So have some plausible process of how you want to go with your training. You might include the tenured faculty position in that, but be realistic and offer up some other ideas of how what you're doing in this will prepare you for multiple possible career tracks. What does it make you tick? That's what they're looking for. They want to get to know you in a matter of a few minutes reading a few pages of text. This is your chance and your opportunity. And this is where you can show that you have already had a broader impact on scientific understanding. This is where you can discuss how important mentoring middle school kids was when you were a high schooler or an undergraduate. This is where you can talk about how you had a blog that talked about, you know, water issues on the Potomac or whatever the issue might be that concerns you. Take your research interest and translate that into something that the public can consume and talk about how that's helped guide you. Because sometimes the public will have a question that can guide future research. Okay, now, relevant background. This is where you're talking about what you've done already. Any kind of research is relevant research. Even if you're an astrophysicist and you did some type of sociological research, you're still learning the process of research. You're learning the customs, the methods, the nature of statistical analyses, the communication style, all of that. Talk about it. You want to come across as a dilettante, but you don't want to come across as so single-minded that that's all you've ever done. Broaden out a little bit, different perspective. Talk about anything, even if it's not directly in your field. Now, anything that you have done that's taken you through the full process of doing science, including hypothesis, formulation, testing, data management, analysis, communication style, all of that shows you understand the bigger picture as to how science is done. You need to be a team member, but also a leader. Show how you can do both. If you initiate a project, you're showing leadership. If you contribute to a project, you're showing teamwork. A global worldview is important. This is where you can talk about your international travel, interaction with international researchers. If there's someone from Italy working in your lab, talk about how you've interacted with that person and learn something about how they do research. Or if you have a project that's international, spell that out and mention how it comes full circle in terms of helping you develop a broader outlook on life and on your science. Any accomplishment, poster, presentation, paper, anything like that, award, grant, anything, mention it. One of the rules of investing is that people rarely like to be the first one. They always want someone else to take the first chance. So if you have some awards, someone else has already taken a chance on you and recognized you. It's easier to garner more support if you get the first one. Graduate research statement, the research proposal. You only have a couple pages, so don't get into too much detail, but talk about the general theory and how your specific area is going to address outstanding gaps in knowledge for that discipline. The idea that general theory is guiding you in terms of formulating hypotheses, you're recognizing gaps in knowledge, you're recognizing holes in information, you're recognizing questions that have been posed by others or something you come up with. You formulate hypotheses, you go out and test them, you have small research exercises, the results of which will inform general theory. it's this virtuous cycle as to how science works. General theory, specific example, back and forth. But they're just moving forward. Now, panelists are experts in the general field. So I would say that if you're in a department of sociology, there'll be a wide range of sociologists in your department. Your proposal should be understandable by anyone in that department. You aren't going to get people who are focusing just on some small, narrow area within sociology. They're going to be from across sociology. And depending upon the application load, there will be mixing and matching of panelist groupings to handle the number of applications that are there. In some cases, you'll get a very narrow set of applications in terms of the research scope. In other cases, they're all over the map, just because of the application load of the panel process. Now, background, motivation, why are you doing this? Talk about that in your personal statement, but also talk about it here. Spell out the details. Not so fine detail you're telling me how many nanograms or whatever you're putting into the reaction, but rather in broad terms. They'll understand that you can figure out what the appropriate quantities of reagents to use would be for your particular experiment. Here, too, bring it back to the broader impact statement. Constantly remind them of what these things are, what the intellectual merit is, and what the broader impacts are. Don't go into great detail here, but just pull it out real quickly. Let the reader know of your plans. This goes beyond the term of your graduate studies. As was before, but again, you're showing them, say, I'm doing this project, and while it would set me up for a career as faculty, it also has these possible career paths that could grow out of work. And always have a plan B. Show some flexibility there. Particularly if you're a senior, you're going to be putting out a very broad statement as to what you want to do. And it will probably change a couple of times before you actually get to a final thesis. So have some flexibility there. Okay, the letters of reference. Choose people who know you as an individual and as a scientist. Don't pick some big name researcher just because they're a big name. They don't know you. Or don't pick someone who you had in a class of 400 students who doesn't really know you. They need to talk about you. If you're a second year, you pretty much have to have your research, your thesis advisor write one of those letters, or the panelists who want to know what's going on. If you are a senior, and you know what lab you want to work in, and you know the PI for that lab, and they're willing to write a letter, that can go a long way in showing that you're thinking ahead, you've made the connection, you know what you're proposing to do. You will be compared with others. There have been thousands of GRFs over the years. They will state their role in the letter. Do not, under any circumstances, use anything more than one word from your advisor's research proposals. There have been instances where students either cut and pasted or the PI wrote part of the application for them. And with text search engines now, there's no way you can get around charges of plagiarism. So just don't do it. There have been applications disqualified because of that. Now, you will need to give them some sufficient time, since the deadlines are pretty soon, like less than 2 months, something like that. If you haven't started already, do it this afternoon. You can track the letters and you can remind the references if they are behind you get an exam. Okay. Applications go in, they're complete, there's some spot checking, they're bundled together. The panels are pulled together. They'll be pulled together over the next month or two. They don't know exactly how many to invite until they see the application load, and then they pick panelists with the appropriate expertise. The panelists are then sent the applications in December and given a few weeks to review these. They're sent as electronically, and each panelist will get about 20 applications and have to work through them. It used to be the panels would all come in a big room like this, and there'd be paper copies, and they would sit and handwrite the reviews. We've progressed a little bit since then. Everything is done electronically now. So the panels get these, and you can see, you can search the web and find an example of what the template looks like. But the panels are asked to review the application and use NSF's traditional poor, fair, good, very good, excellent checkbox, which
Did you hear your PSA? Hey, I got two excellence and a good, but they still didn't fund me. I'll get to that in a second.
What happens is that NSF's traditional review process for proposals uses this checkbox approach. It's very qualitative, very subjective, and actually, I don't find it to be as useful as what the GRF uses. So the panelists we asked, intellectual merit, broader impacts, use the 5-point checkbox, fill in a paragraph or so of text to give some feedback to the applicant, and then, based on the ensemble review of the entire application, give a numerical score here. The numerical score is from 1 to 50. It's just any scaling you could work around it. So the panelists give comments, and the comments are meant to go back to the applicants, but also to inform the program office if there's any concern or additional information needed. And the reviews that come out now are actually quite good. Back in the day when they were handwritten, you couldn't read half of them, and they only had a few minutes to write them anyway. Okay, now, those scores come in, and out of the 20, the Z-scores approach is used to normalize them across the 20 that I reviewed, or you reviewed, or whoever reviewed. The average Z-score, then, of all the panels to review a single application is then used to rank the applications in that panel. And the real sad reality is that there are only 2 or 3 reviews per application. Now, NSF's policy is that every proposal or application is supposed to get 3 reviews, but they have this out by saying, but we have a pre-review process which only requires 2 reviews. So what they do is, well, there are 2 reviews, at least they were doing this, they might have up to 3 this year, I know they were discussing that. Based on that average, they kind of go out and say, okay, this is our ranking. They get rid of the bottom 2/3, they look at the top 1/3, the additional review, and then a final ranking. And from that group, they determine who is going to get an award for the most part. Panelist ranking is the single most important determinant of success. Roughly speaking, if they have, say there are 100 applications, and they can give 10 awards, what they'll do is tell the panelists, okay, review them, rank them, they'll take the top 15, and then the top 8 or so are given an award automatically. And then of the next 7, they will use various other criteria to decide who gets one. This is the point where they balance the outcome. And the goal is for any individual from an underrepresented group, essentially underrepresented minorities and women, the success rates will be no lower than the proportion of applications in that panel. So if half of the applications are from women, half of the awards go to women. And that's where they use that flexible range of the next 7 to make certain that those numbers balance out. There's some other variables like where you went to high school. And what that does is says, well, that's really something you have no control over. You, your parents moved, you went there. Believe it or not, Texas is the state that benefits the most from this because Texas underfunds its K-12 education system. And as a result, a proportionally few scientists and engineers coming from Texas as their home state relative to the population overall. So a few extra points are given to Texans here. Final ranking there, that's what I just went through.
Question?
Yes, sir.
Does that apply to people who are Texas residents, or did you have to go to a Texas high school?
That's historically how they have tracked it. I don't know how they're tracking it now in terms of residents or... Yes, sir.
So, can you just clarify the point you made about the review process? So, if you said 2/3, so they'll all be reviewed by 2 reviewers, but then the top 1/3 will be reviewed by 3?
Yes, they may have gone up to 3 reviews because doing it electronically, they can speed up the operation, or really they know they can take more of the reviewer's time. So they may have gone to 3 reviews. And this transition of removing 1 year of eligibility at the graduate level, and it's really hard to know what they will come with. Because another thing is resources. It used to be they were flying everyone in, and so one way of saving money was to just don't fly as many people in.
But now, since it's all virtual, I can't speak for certainty because some of these things you don't know until the panel actually convenes. And the NSF people know. And they won't tell you the stuff of what the panel composition is. Another thing on the panel composition, what they do is try to get demographics that reflect the current undergraduate science and engineering population, not the current professoriate, the groups that are otherwise underrepresented. So the panels informed are meant to have a demographic composition that reflects the current undergraduate science and engineering population. Not
demographic in terms of what?
Race, gender, ethnicity. It is not looking at the current professoriate, which is decidedly not representative of the population overall, nor of the undergraduate population. So the NSF is taking some active and delicate approaches to balancing the portfolio and you know, making it more fair and representative. Okay, so the awards are issued, and then everyone in that next group, plus a few others, get honorable mention. Everybody's listed on the Fastlane website in spring. The honorable mention needs to get access to the supercomputing resources. Obviously, the awardees get the money, but it's still an accomplishment. A lot of people will put honorable mention on their resumes. That's a perfectly legitimate thing to do. The final numbers are depending on funding. They won't know until March. We live in a world of continuing resolutions. We're supposed to have a new budget October 1st, but we won't have one. We'll just be slogging along based on the current year numbers. And then they'll come up with something. And this year is a huge challenge, so we'll just see what happens. There have been other years, like the year of the recession. I would happen to be there at that point. And they were shoveling money into the NSF like there was no tomorrow. So we had realized success rates that year, like 25%, 39% mathematics. Fun times. Now, the success rates across the disciplines are fundamentally equal. It's based on a number of applications. So it's a 10% success rate overall. Everybody enjoys that same success rate. There used to be, and may still be, some small pockets of money that help enhance certain areas. Like computer science, they usually have extra money to throw in or a few extra ones. And there used to be special programs for women and minorities to enhance their representation in certain disciplines like engineering and chemistry. But those have been done away with as well.
Are MD, PhD applicants eligible?
Nope. Have you been sitting here for 45 minutes, Bernard? Yep. I should have mentioned that before. That's in the solicitation now. MD, PhD students. You're welcome to have some questions. okay, and you're just about right. So, if you have questions, the first place to go is the solicitation. Read it. It's wonky, but read it. Most of your questions will be answered there. I'm certain that Maria can help you with a lot of other questions. Online application user guides, this is also found, these are also found through Fastlane, which is the application portal. The Operations Center is actually, I think, still a contractor over on DuPont Circle. And they answer the phone for the most part, do a lot of the processing. But they can also answer most of your questions, and then you can actually track. Call the office as well. They'll answer the phone there, but you can track them down. One final thing is, if you want to get a sense as to what NSF feels is important about the progress of the program overall, here's a review or evaluation they did a few years ago, and it just gives you some insight on what they think is beneficial and useful for the program. So with that, I thank you for your time, and I'm happy to answer questions.
Are you going to have the graduate research office available as a resource?
Okay, I don't work there,
okay.
But yes. No, you're right.
Okay. If the funding is used to the course of 3 years, should your proposed project be a 3-year project?
No. You want it to be a graduate program, for the most part, to be a doctoral program. Now, you should be, you should use whatever the norms are for your discipline. I guess it's normally a 5 or 6 year program. Spell it out as such.
The project that you described, should you describe it as the first
no,
year?
No, describe the whole project. As your 6-year plan of study, the 3 years will be incorporated as you see fit. They'll assume you'll find funding for the other years. So you want to describe your graduate program and how you want to develop a thesis and how broad it is. Does that make sense? So describe your describe your graduate study, recognizing that Tony isn't totally through, but it'll go a long way in helping you get there.
Is your idea will only necessarily take you like 6 months to do? Is that too small of an idea?
Would you be able to get a PhD off of that?
Okay, no.
6 month PhD. Give me a call if you're able to do that.
If we're applying as a second year grad student, is it okay to include a letter of reference from our undergraduate institution?
Sure, sure. They know you, they know your trajectory. You could be something last 5 years or so. Yeah, I hope if we kept in touch with them, by all means.
Maybe we're in a question. MD, PhD, or do MD?
MD, no.
Okay.
Are you also here for?
Not that okay. Yeah, so.
So if you're an undergrad now and you want to be a postback student, you can still apply throughout those years.
Sure.
And then you graduate with those.
Sure. You encounter the graduate. It's one of the issues that I had with for a long time. I think in certain fields that have to give certain kinds of students crazy answers. But go for it, it's their rules.
Do they look at your undergrad semester and
yep.
How like do they label
it? It just depends, you know, you went to the great shot, and what you were carrying, how relevant is to your preparation. It's not to say you could be an art history major, but if you have the preparation through some experience, maybe you work the summers as a lab tech or something, it could be fine. Maybe you have different insights.
I'm in the second year of part-time master's program here. I'm 4 years out of undergrad. Am I eligible to apply for PhD programs?
You're in the second year of a part-time graduate program.
Master's program.
You're perfectly eligible because you have, as of August 1st, no more than 1 year, 12 months of full-time graduate study. So, but confer with them to make certain that they understand what you're doing. It used to be that they counted credit hours, and that was the measure, but it's hard to do because of the different scales. If you have quarter systems, semester, maybe you have summer. There's some bridge programs where students come in the summer and they're taking classes and the like. They don't count towards a degree. There's some different things. But as I understand it, you're eligible to contact them to confirm.
Thank you.
How are ESMS programs
with
the combined programs?
Okay. Look at the solicitation because there is language about ESMS programs and how they count. Essentially, any coursework that you take that counts towards your master's degree is considered graduate. And therefore, if you're in your final year of a typically 5-year BSMS program, that would count as graduate study. But look to see the language in the solicitation, because there is some that specifically relates to that. And it changes a little bit over the years.
So I'm in a 1-year master's program, and I'm not sure what kind of research I'll be doing, you know, next year. So if I'm describing my proposed project, how solidified or consistent can it be?
I won't say that being vague is going to help you, because if you don't know, you don't know. But I would throw out some really clear ideas. You're going to have enough clarity to have some background literature review, to have some sense of who's working in that field, what are the appropriate programs, what methodology, et cetera, happens to be in that area. It doesn't have to be absolutely crystal clear. And as a master's student, you're kind of in this middle ground. You're not in a PhD program where you're expected to be working on identifying your project during your first year of graduate study. But you're trying to finish a master's degree, which is a different focus. But you need to have enough clarity to make it viable.
So the clarity should be like the field, not so much necessarily the lab or the
right.
Person you're working
with. Right, but be careful, because if you feel you don't have enough of this pulled together, it may be better for you to wait until next year when you're in a program. But getting the award, it's amazing how weightless move right after the award are issued.
So my master's program doesn't require a thesis to receive a degree, but is that necessary? Like, do you have to have your research for your thesis, or I guess you want to get a research-based degree?
So you're in a 2-year master's degree?
Yeah.
It's coursework only?
It can be either one. I wasn't planning on doing it.
My suggestion would be that if you want to show that you're research-minded, that you pursue a thesis.
Okay.
Simply because doing coursework alone won't give them any idea about what kind of research you can do. And again, you might be better off waiting until next year when you're in the thick of things.
for your thesis work.
I saw another question on my way out, but can you apply and defer the award if you're thinking about taking a gap year?
I'm sorry?
Can you apply and then defer the award if you're thinking about taking a gap year?
You would have to talk to them about that. If you're given an award, you're actually given a lot of flexibility. And generally speaking, they like that because they don't have to spend any money this year. They'll make them assume they'll have money next year. So generally speaking, if you have that, the problem is if you start telling them you're going to take a gap year, they're going to tell you wait. And you know, you don't want to blow a chance, although you have chances now if you're not a graduate student yet. So.
There are expectations that you have a program that you would begin as of fall 2018.
Yeah.
The fear is that, at least my fear is that if you do that and you're awarded, then you may effectively forfeit that first year of funding. So if you have questions, just let me know and I'll reach out to you.
Do you have to apply to the field of research that you are getting?
You don't have to apply to that, but they'll want to know why you're applying to some other area.
Okay.
Because they'll see what your program of study is. If you have your advisor or whatever, they'll see that. If you have a different research plan, then you need to have a plan that's not just for this audience, but you need to have all your global issues dealt with.
Okay.
And if you have a line that doesn't flat out take you, and if you have an argument that you could really transform things in that area, if you have money, that might be workable, but they will see what you're proposing to do and where you are, and want to know why there's a gap.
Okay, thank you. So if you're applying and making your proposal while you're also applying to graduate schools, if you make your entire proposal based off of one lab at one university, do you have to attend that university?
You don't have to attend that. There's a lot of portability. Once you get the award, you can change institutions, you can change fields, you can change advisors, you can do all that, but you need to be in communication with NSF in your home institution. Because you can be denied by your home institution, you can be denied by NSF. But for the most part, if it's reasonably connected, you're fine. You might get a new research opportunity or a new study opportunity that you didn't have before. That's the kind of thing that you're amenable to approve.
Yeah, I think this is solicitation, but if you're awarded, you have to attend graduate school in the United States. Or
I think that they no longer allow overseas study. I think that's correct. When I was there, we had about 20 students, most of them anyway, but were international students. I think they removed that.
I think they might still allow some.
No, I need to check in on that.
You should reach out to me.
Okay. They're a hassle because getting the money to you is there's no university that sent it to you.
Yes.
What services can the graduate school fellowship offer to a graduate student to help prepare for this award? Perhaps Ms. Snyder could answer that question for us.
I'm available, as I said in the emails that I've been sending out. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them for you. If I can't answer them, I'll definitely get an answer for you. If you'd rather go through me to work directly with the NSF GRFP group, which is the one organization that handles all the applications on behalf of the NSF. I'm also happy to review statements if you like. I need a lot of advanced time for that, so I have a lot of different programs that I oversee. We also are offering the grant writing workshops, which I mentioned in my messages. The fall series is sort of in the planning stages, but I'll be announcing that soon. The first part one will be go over some of the what's in the solicitation, but also to strategically frame your statements to be competitive. That will happen at the end of September. With the second part, which is going to be more of a roundtable review of drafts, where you work with faculty and then writing tutors, really kind of looking at those drafts and teasing out any issues. That will happen at the beginning of October. So that's coming down the pipeline, and I'll let everyone know via the distribution list that I confirmed registration. So we all know about that. And the Writing Center is always open. You can all set up appointments with a writing tutor. For those in the sciences, there'll be students versed in the sciences who can help you write your statements. Highly encourage that. There's an online registration system. I'm happy to share that information with you if you've ever used their online registration system. They're a great resource. They're located in the second floor of the library right by Midnight Mug, so you can get some talking, and you can go right in there and meet someone. They're a great group, and I'm happy. Again, I'll follow up with that information for all of you, and I'll also follow up with the two other programs that are sort of follow the same format and framework as the NSF, one offered by the Department of Energy, and the other one offered by DOD. In the event there are students who also want to apply to those. And we have just two students who are, while you don't have any questions for Professor Hahn, we have a award recipient from last year and an honorary from last year's recipient of another prestigious award. And they're here to give just brief comments on their respective experiences, and if you want to ask them any questions, I think we're open to that as well. Marissa Putnam from Psychology and the Emma Gardner from Industry.
So I'm in the psychology department, and I just finished my first year of the fellowship. So I think my first recommendation is go to the workshops that Maria was talking about. I went to both of them, and it feels really uncomfortable because you have to talk to people from other departments, and they critique your work, but I think it was helpful in the end. And I think it helped move, like, get real drafts because I had to have something on paper to bring to the workshops. And in the workshop, something that I thought was really helpful that they did was they made everyone write down a timeline, like very, very detailed, step by step. And while I was doing it, I was thinking, you know, I probably won't use this. This feels really minute, but I think it really helped. Because then you have something you can look back at, and if you're not meeting your timeline, it's harder to just not. I guess it's harder to not focus on your timeline if you have. I think we kind of talked about this before, but I would strategize what year you apply and have a talk with your advisor. So in my first year, my advisor and I talked, and I decided not to apply. And because we thought in the second year I may have a stronger application with some conference presentations and maybe a publication. So now that you can only apply once, I think that's more important than before. I would say work closely with a professor and advisor when you're making your project idea, because they'll know more about the body of literature that you're talking about. They'll be able to help you brainstorm and whittle down ideas and shape them into something that will end up in your statement. And I would say read papers that you think are interesting to you and figure out how that can kind of fit into the work your lab is doing. Like if there's an area that you specifically find interesting in your lab, you don't have to create a project from scratch. You can kind of work from the base that you have in lab. And I have a lot of people read my statement, and I think like personal statement can be, it's really personal, and it can feel really vulnerable to have people read it, but I think having people that are in your lab, out of your lab, maybe people that aren't in your discipline outside of these workshops, I think that's really helpful, especially when you're defining things, just to make sure you're being extra clear. And the last piece of information I had was consider, I didn't realize until I got into the application that you can choose, and I'm not sure if it's still this way, but I could choose like within psychology how I wanted to split the funding. And you might have talked about this when I was here. But so I think 60% maybe developmental psychology and 40% STEM learning. So I think there's different funding for each different area.
No, it's just when they're pulling together and ended up with an interdisciplinary panel, they thought the interdisciplinarity was a bucket. So you would get crazy combinations,
okay.
And there's no way to review it. So now what happens is your 60% would determine which panel it would go to.
Okay.
And if STEM learning was something they needed to get input on, they would find a reviewer who did STEM learning and contribute that.
So maybe it's less important.
No, emphasize interdisciplinarity.
by all means.
Yeah, and I think that's another way to indicate that it is interdisciplinary. And there's more, there was many options that I didn't expect to be in there, so I would say look at all of them and don't just pick the broadest one. Checking the lab.
All right, my name is Evan Gardner. I'm a third year PhD student in chemistry, and full disclosure, I didn't go to any of these when they were offered. So that's probably why I'm an honorable mention, not actually sure. So what I'm going to tell you, I don't know really the nitty gritty details. I just learned that you only have one shot now at this. So let me just tell you sort of the story of how it evolved. So I didn't get it the first time, and I got honorable mention the second time. And the thing that really changed for me then is I got two publications as a co-author, and I sort of tidied up the way I wrote my research proposal. I made it clear, made it more abundantly clear to everyone, and not just in a way that it was how I formatted the science, but just general formatting, just walking the idea through, being sort of a general approach, why it's significant to everyone in the world, but also, you know, add a little bit of chemistry in that's very approachable, it's not too much in the lingo, and then end with sort of tying it all back in together. But yeah, I don't have too much advice for just the small details of all your specific scenarios, but anyone here is an undergraduate student, or, yeah, so I had a professor once tell us that you can do the thing where you apply to labs while you're applying to the QFP as a way to leverage your position to a lab that you want to get into, and that's actually really effective strategy. So if you're in a do or die scenario where you're really looking for this funding, I do suggest do it when you have a clearer shot at it, meaning more publications, more experience, or things that would allow you to get the funding. Because it is extremely competitive, and I'm not going to make any sort of illusion that it isn't. So if you're an undergrad looking to do this, then you have to do a lot more legwork. You have to sort of start to master a field and sort of narrow in on a focus that doesn't seem so nebulous. You don't want to say, I want to work on X because it seems cool. You're going to have to see, tell them how you're going to be able to operate and how you're going to be able to execute and use strategy or at least understand what you're doing. Because you have to make a significant contribution for them to actually want you to want to fund this sort of idea. You can't just think that something's cool and you really dreamed your entire life of working on this. You have to actually display some sort of ability that you are going to be able to carry that through. So I think that's one piece of advice there. go for it in that scenario, but if you are a first or second year graduate student, well, second year is your last year right, going into it, but if you're a first year graduate student and you're not sure that your project's quite there yet or you don't have the idea quite narrowed down, I would hold off until you maybe have a little more experience. But between my time applying for the first time and the second time, like I said, I had two publications, but I'd also been in grant writing mode with my PM. We had been applying for multiple grants, which are actually successful, so I sort of got a taste for what grant writing was all about. How you break things down into components that you can execute, and how that you can also just sort of tie it into the general idea of the things that you're going after in a clear way, because the difference here is the Department of Energy and the National Institute of Health, they are going for a very specific idea. People reviewing the work are very much in tune with what you're doing. But in this scenario, you have to sort of back off a little bit on the science. You can't get too far into the weeds, or you can't go too far into specifics without sort of having it be approachable. So those are the sort of the main things I want to get across here. As far as the personal statement goes, feel comfortable with it. Don't feel afraid to tell a story about it, but also try to go back to the science a little bit. So that's what I try to do, is talk about how I view science and why I think it's important, and I think that makes a good story. But again, that's your personal statement. It's all really up to you and your story about creativity. So basically I'm a runner-up. So you can take what I say with a grain of salt, basically. But I was successful in getting a different grant, and the grants that we did apply for during that 7th year, we were also successful in getting to. So I think.
Did you have the honorable mention? Do you think that influenced your successful grant applications?
No. I got some, also heads up, some of the reviewers are not necessarily nice people. You don't have to be a nice person to review this stuff. In fact, I'm sort of on the idea that you don't have to be a nice person, that helps. There was a question. Does your undergraduate performance affect this? And I would say yes. because one of the reviewers actually said that I had a disturbingly poor academic record in undergraduate. And I went home really mad and had a beer, calmed down. And I thought about it for a little bit, and I thought kind of like I got a little bit broadsided by that. So the institution I went to, Boston University, is known for sort of grade deflation. So this is sort of a thing that hangs over me from my academic career, unfortunately. The average for my major was about 2.75, so just a reference. So you also, there isn't as much of a grade requirement, but be sure to sort of talk about grades if you feel that you're in a deficit for grades. But I think from what I heard earlier, the majority of your performance is sort of based on the merit of your work and the work they're proposing. But there is a contribution to your grades too. And if you feel that they are not great, then maybe talk about it. Maybe there's a life experience or some sort of thing that you have to overcome in undergraduate, or there is something about your undergraduate career that has hurt your grades in some way. Maybe talk about that and explain it. I was just in a Harvard major, that's all. So I can't really say too much about that, but everything's fine. Any questions for me, I guess?
Any questions for Evan or Marissa?
Do they tend to focus more on grades that are relevant to the subject you're applying for, or do they look holistically?
I think they kind of specifically said the chemistry grades were the ones we really cared about, and those tend to be my hardest courses. So I had a professor once tell us that you're not paying all this money for A's, and that's sort of the crap that I think something like that.
That's it. One of my reviewers commented that my grad school grades were too low in my first year too, so maybe, I don't know, or it's hard on me.
Well, it is very competitive, so they have to pick on something.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, but all of you got into Georgetown or Georgetown grad, so.
You both are doing great, so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it all worked out. But I guess so it didn't matter.
Yeah, that's why I
like it. And to Evan, to your point, David Lightfoot, who's one of our professors here, and former dean of the graduate school, he served as the director of later for 3 years. And he told me personally that the distinction between recipient and honorable mention recipient is like tiny. It really does come down to your funding. So I wouldn't put yourself down.
And he also said the personal he would never underestimate the personal statement that is, and I think that's what Professor Hahn also said as well. And Professor Gale, who used to do this as well, they said, you know, a lot of people think, oh, that's just kind of like a biography or something.
It's very.
Because you can address the issues, the red flags or the yellow flags.
Yeah, you kind of can use the personal statement to your advantage in any way, shape, or form. I think that's why it's there.
It's really filling the blanks on the things that maybe your transcripts and then your research, anything, everything else sort of letters that you necessarily don't paint the entire picture. The personal statements where you can really explain certain aspects of your portfolio or your application.
I think in the workshop, the writing workshop, they really focused on, like, you obviously know how you got from place to place on your resume, but you have to connect the dots for your readers, and the personal statement is that it's the right place to do
it. I don't mean to scare people away from this, but that's, at the very least, the application itself has helped me sort of center my focus around my research, and that was a major tool for me to go forward and go towards my qualification exams for my PhD, is that I had this really nice focus and this really nice piece that I could sort of, you know, after I wrote it, I thought, hey, like, there's this cool work that I can do now. I got to go. And I got a lot of ideas about what I was going to do from there on. So anytime you have a chance to do that, you still win at the end of the day.
I agree. Since I wrote the application, I've been reusing the literature from that and building on that idea, and you get, as you're applying, if you're sharing your statement, you're getting other people invested in your project idea, so I think it was really helpful.
And just to plug the grant writing workshops, just the mere exercise of placing words to paper, it's so liberating. It just kind of gets you going. It's harder to do that on your own, I think, when you're in a group where that's sort of till the next 15, 20 minutes, just rewrite what it is you want to focus on, what this what the research is going to be, or what your personal statement is going to be. There's some place to, you know, you have to do it, you have to perform, and then you have to present it. So having to go through that process, I think, is very helpful. It gets students really started on the writing. And then having to come back from the second part and share those drafts, kind of places, I mean, it does place you in a position to have to perform and get it done. And then the timeline works very well. And then the other part of it too is I can share them now, or we'll share them as part of the workshop, but I can share actual copies of successful proposals, both the personal statement and the research statement, if you'd like to sort of get a sense of what that looks like.
I thought reading the letters from other disciplines was especially helpful because you don't know all the lingo and you see how other fields define words and concepts in a way that you can understand without having a lot of knowledge about it.
And just how people approach, how different students have approached the personal statement, I think, is very helpful. Because there's not just one way to do it. Variety of different ways to approach it, to sort of have those examples before and have sort of everyone as a group discuss it is really helpful as well.
And being like pursuing higher education, one of the major skill sets that you're going to have to develop is being able to communicate what you do to people who aren't specialists. And I think this is one way you can start thinking about things, because at the end of the day, if I said what I did, nobody's going to.